It's about 7:30 in the evening, and I'm about to spend the night in a small refugee camp in a Greek village. I'm winding down for the evening, and I make my way to a familiar spot, a place that I go. It's a pile of wooden pallets, and it lets me overlook 100 olive trees and the ocean. I have my binoculars, and I look over the sea, the Aegean Sea, to see if there are any boats full of refugees coming over from the mountains of Turkey. I sit there, and I watch the sunset over the water, but then I hear them before I see them. 100 individual bells clanking together as they make their way down the road. A large herd of sheep make their presence known as they walk past me. Heads down, they're looking for food. They stop in the middle of the road because they found something. They create a roadblock for the rest of the herd. Some go wander off to the side and eat from the bushes. And then comes along the shepherd. And he has an olive branch and he whacks them and he gives them a call I could never replicate even if I tried. And eventually, they make their way back into the sheepfold. Throughout my summer, I became very enamored with sheep, which is very funny for me because I don't consider myself an animal person, but I found myself loving them. I could hear the sheep as I fell asleep every night while I was in Greece. I would stop for them as I drove through the mountains, and they would take the pedestrian right-of-way. Each time I could hear the shepherd speak to them, they knew his voice, they would obey his command, and they would move. I was oddly captivated with sheep, and I desired to learn more and more about this relationship between a sheep and a shepherd. So I started asking people, Greek locals and people I was working with, and eventually I was talking with this woman one day, and she began to explain to me that when a sheep wanders away from the flock, the shepherd will break the legs of the sheep. He does this so that he can carry the sheep on his shoulders, and then the legs can heal. But it's during this time of being carried that sheep come to know the voice of the shepherd. They know his scent, they know his nearness, they trust him, they're dependent on him to move. And it is during this time that the sheep's legs heal, so that when they are fully healed, they don't wander. They know the voice of the shepherd, and they're near to him. After this woman explained this to me, I very clearly felt in my spirit the Lord was telling me, and Hannah, like so, I have been carrying you for a long time. I'm going to invite you into a bit of my story here at Gordon. But I want to recognize that what I have already said and what I'm going to say is limited. There's much more to be said. And even with what I just said in that story, I don't want to indicate that I think God is a shepherd who breaks our legs. Just gonna say that. I think we need to know that, and I think we understand that God is not in the business of breaking people. Rather, he wants to carry us so that we can know healing. I want to invite you to come into my story, and hopefully you can find yourself in here somewhere. My time at Gordon has been full, and I don't mean being overcommitted, although that has happened as well. It's been full of seasons of joy, of transformation, and of growth. I've been challenged, and I've been taught to think critically and to listen well. I've made incredible friends who have inspired me and who have loved me deeply, and I'm leaving Gordon a much different person because of the people I've encountered here. My peers, staff members, and faculty. The people here have shaped me, and I am better for it, especially people I have disagreed with. I would be honest if I pretended that this wasn't my whole story. In many different seasons at Gordon, I have felt pretty broken. It's not that I felt God as a shepherd had broken my legs, rather circumstances, difficulties of life, people and life had just broken me. While at Gordon, I've experienced deep pain. Wounds were created and trust was really broken. I've been disappointed, and I came face to face with my darkness that is within me. And it is very ugly. I've had to work through places of deep insecurity. I've been through long seasons of spiritual dryness and loneliness. I'm very good at trying to do things on my own. I like my independence, and this often took shape when I would try to recover from pain and from heartache on my own. But the summer was very different. I spent my summer on the island of Lesbos, Greece, and this is where 500,000 refugees have crossed from Turkey and have tried to get through Europe through that point of entry. And each day as I worked in this refugee camp, I found myself sitting down with a new refugee friend, and they were just unloading their pain, their trauma, ways that they have seen ISIS destroy their cities, killed their families. I heard it all. I listened to their stories, their individual experiences, real lived experiences, and I started to carry that, and I felt very weak. This past summer was very difficult, and in many ways, it broke me. And yet, this is when Jesus showed me that he was carrying me. I was that dumb sheep who wandered off the side of the road, and he held me on his shoulders so that I could heal. It was in being carried over these past 4 years that my intimacy with Jesus was built. I learned his voice, I knew his nearness in places of darkness, and this is where I learned to be dependent on him. It was in these places of brokenness that shaped me more than anything else. I had nothing else but him. I was dependent. I had to have him. I learned more of who he was, and not who I wanted him to be, but who he is, and who he was, and who he will be. Jesus showed me that the Lord is our shepherd, and the only good one at that. He is completely loving. He is patient and gentle. He has laid his life down for us. He is tender and sacrificial. He is protective and sheltering. He devotes his life to the sheep to be their shepherd. He tells us where to step and he directs us. He protects so that we can find rest. He knows each of us intimately, and he promises that we will know his voice. He gives us true rest, for his pasture is our place of refuge. Throughout my time at Gordon, I've learned that Jesus was actually someone I could trust, especially after my trust had been broken with a lot of people. But trust turned to love. The sheep know their shepherd. This is something that we've heard before, right? What I'm saying is not really new. We've heard this, it's simplistic. But think about it. The sheep know him because he spends time with them. He's among them. He cares for them. He speaks to them so they are always hearing his voice. He wants them to know his voice so they will not follow the voice of a stranger. They know him. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, has carried me for a long time now. He has allowed space for me to heal, to be dependent on him, to be loved and tended to and taken care of. Now, seniors, I can't stand up here and pretend that our time at Gordon has not been easy. It feels like we have experienced just about everything, and then some. And many people are left wounded. Throughout my time at Gordon, I have wrestled with theology and have lived in the tension of what has happened on our campus. I have listened to people's stories and I have read your many words online. There have been dark seasons where I was deconstructing my faith so I could figure out what the Bible really said and what it really meant. And in this time, I was trying to see who Jesus really was and what I really believed about him. Does this resonate with any of you? I wonder if our stories are beginning to cross. In these places of pain and weakness and deep struggle, I felt like that sheep that was wandering. I am a dumb sheep. But God showed me that not only had he been carrying me, but I was tethered to him, that we were tethered. And when I think about being tethered, I think of this imagery, and I'm sure there is a better picture for it, but this is what I think of. I think of a rope tied around my waist, and then it extends to him, and it's tied around his waist. And so that is the image that I have of being tethered. It's this idea of connectedness. While at Gordon, I have felt all over the place, ideologically, theologically, spiritually, and emotionally. And it was messy. But it was okay because not only was I tethered to him, but rather he was tethered to me. My doubts and my questions and my wanderings didn't shake him. It didn't cause him to leave. He didn't say, you know, I'm just gonna like unhook this tether and like you can go off and like do your thing because you don't want to be tethered to me. He's not like that. You may have also struggled with your faith throughout the past 4 years. You may have come to Gordon in love with Jesus and are leaving and you don't feel tethered to him. Hear the hope that he has for you. He is tethered to you. There is union there. A covenant was made and it has promised to never leave us. He is our good shepherd. There's nothing you can do. He's committed to you. He's in it. And even if you felt like you wanted to remove yourself from him, he's in it with you, almost whether you like it or not. I don't know if I can say that, but he's in it. Find rest in that. He promises that he alone can give us rest. He says, come to me. I'm gentle and humble in heart. And he's talking to those who are weary and heavy burdened, and that is an internal and an external exhaustion. Quite frankly, a spiritual exhaustion. And he says, come to me, for only in me can you find rest. You are still his sheep, and you will hear his voice. As Gordon students, we often pride ourselves on being intellectuals. But really, we are dumb sheep. We're really stupid. And we need to be dependent on the voice of the shepherd, our shepherd. We are his sheep. You are still his sheep. We are often broken, but he is inviting us to be dependent on him. He is inviting us to be carried by him while also reminding us that he is tethered to us. Thank you.
Hey guys, it's like a really long walk, sorry. First of all, can we thank the senior band? I mean, there's been years of service and just like, they were great. Sahenga is really good at cajon, so that was really good. I'm gonna try to be like edgy and just like walk around, but it's like a really long stage, so like I might spend the whole time just like walking across, and I don't know. So I just pace when I'm nervous, and this is something very different than I've ever done. I'm usually here just like playing or singing and two questions that I get asked a lot is what is up with your hair, and I have absolutely no idea. I've kind of like last year I was trying to figure out like I want to save money, so I'm not going to do haircuts because they're kind of expensive. So I just started like shaving the sides and kind of like doing like the normal like undercut that a lot of guys have, and then I just realized like my top, I didn't know how to cut it, so I like it's just like this, and I get asked that. My parents don't really like it, but I've committed to doing it for the rest of the year and just seeing what happens. And also, I got asked to the other day if I dress up like this for fun every day, and I don't. It's for work, so dress codes. So today I'm just gonna touch on like three things, and it's a really nice day out, so I'll be quick and try to get you guys out of here. So at Gordon, I've really learned a lot about the value of mentorship. Last year and part of this year, I co-led morning chapel band. And one of the pluses of that is that you get to hang out with Bill like every week, which is like really fun. I would go into the office, sit down, and like start playing guitar, and we'll just like talk about like everything. not music much, which is great. And I swear Bill's range has gotten higher, like his vocal range has gotten higher since I've gotten here. Like I was just hearing him sing right now and I was like, oh my gosh, that's crazy. But the greatest thing about Bill is that, and like our relationship is that we come from very different backgrounds and we're very different. And we have very different ideas of different things, like music styles, like when you do different things. And I think like that really helped me grow a lot. Because I'm talking with somebody who's equally affirming me in what I'm doing, but also kind of pushing back on me. And I think like that's really important. I think we need more of that. I think we always seek friends that are very similar to us and different people. And so I think just like most of, like a lot of the learning you do at Gordon is not just academics, but like I think I always just throw out random percentages, so I'll say like 52% of it is like hanging out with friends, learning from different people, and like what you do outside of classes. So I think like along that line, I think talking with Bill like almost weekly was like one of the greatest things. It was funny, he would teach me just random things like in music, but also just like say, hey, Andrew, you need to chill right now. Or just like really say, slow down, Andrew, like what is God trying to tell you? What are you trying to do? I've noticed I've been on the left side, so I'll go on the right side. So Bill has taught me a lot about like being more aware of different cultural systems at work. So we have a very diverse campus for a Christian school, and I think that a lot of times like I can think something is like great and like fine and like there's nothing like wrong with it, but like I think if you start hanging out with people that like you don't maybe like have not like been in the same background with or experiences with, like you'll start seeing like, oh, this is another way to think about this, or I can start empathizing with why these people feel this way. And I think that's just like the beginning of understanding. Okay, so 2.2, 3-point sermon. All right. So sustainability. Throughout my time at Gordon, so actually freshman year, I auditioned for Chapel Band, and I was like, oh yeah, I'm gonna make it, it's gonna be great. And I didn't make it, and that actually turned out to be like one of the like best moments of my life, actually. Because it like started, like I felt like entitled. Like I had played music in church all my life, and it was just like the natural step at school. Like, oh, I'm just gonna be in Chapel Band because that's what one of my friends from high school comes here, Logan, he plays drums for Morning Chapel Band, and he was like, yeah, I'm gonna audition. I was like, great, same. And I think like I started realizing like there's so much more to like what happens like in worship. And so like I started developing a worship theology and just really started to wrestle with some hard questions, like why do I do things in life, right? Like am I just self-serving? And so I think I really learned through that, like, hey, like it's not about me. And so like I started developing a vision. I actually joined Chapel Band as a bassist, which like I suck at bass. So I started realizing like, wow, like I have a vision for like what I want like chapel worship to be at school, and like I tried to do as much as I could to make that happen. And I think I realized at a certain point last year, I was like co-leading Morning Chapel Band. I was playing with Evening Chapel a lot. I was also doing Catacombs a decent amount and just playing in different things. And like I realized like it had started to creep in again of just doing things to do it. And I became very like not trusting of others to like carry on this vision that we had all agreed on. And so I started realizing that like I may not see this like vision come to fruition while I'm at Gordon, but how can I better equip people after me to do my job better than I did? And I think that's like a goal that we should be, really seeking to develop here. Like, are there other students that I can like pass off skills or different things I know so that like when I'm gone, Gordon is a better place? Because, you know, you're here for 4 years and that's like not too long, which I just realized today, like, wow, I'm like almost done with school. And I think that ties into my last point, which is about control. I'm a very controlling person. Like, I like things to be like, yes, this is what I want. And like, if you do anything else, like, what are you doing? I like really learned that like, and Bill has helped me with this a lot, and my girlfriend Kelly, and just like a lot of like my apartment mates too, just like I gotta chill out a lot. And I think I really learned that like last year at that like critical point where I was like, I'm doing way too much. And I think like God really spoke to me in this, saying like, and challenged me, like, are you okay with not knowing what's going next? Like, are you okay with being up here and not knowing like if the drummer's gonna like follow your lead and build? They're like, not. Like, because that type of thing, like, got me even, too. And, like, are you okay with just giving it all to God and, like, trusting him to make something good out of something? I know this is a very cliche, I guess, concept, but this is something that really hit me while I was reflecting on this. And so I think this is really notable in, like, trying to figure out what I'm doing, like, next year and, like, out of school. And, like, there's some really awesome opportunities coming up in my life, but I'm also trying to really kind of actually give it to God and be like, all right, if this doesn't work out, I'm not going to, like, freak out. Like, I'm going to be okay. Because, like, in the big scheme of things, like, maybe this is the right thing that's going to happen. And so, true to my word, it's 11:05. Great. I'm going to end on this piece of scripture that's been really, really, really helpful in me processing this whole experience of sharing in chapel. It's from Philippians 4:6-7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So I'm going to pray, and then you guys are free to enjoy the day. Dear Jesus, thank you for this wonderful experience to be up here, Lord, and to just share with the students. And I just thank you for this wonderful community, and I pray that everybody would enjoy this end of the year, and that there would be great weather for everybody as finals comes. In your name we pray, amen. All right, see you guys.